Ms. Jones was here today.
Early. Ms. Jones was the first one here, I believe.
Yep, I came in for the lights.
We left off with him on direct, so he'll finish direct and then we'll have cross, redirect, recross, and then questions from the board.
Can I ask?
Sure. They said they may have one more in the county, of course, that's right, all above. Good morning to all of you. It's 9:30 a.m. on the 13th. We're about to begin day two of the Chairman Cranford appeal hearing. Mr. Cranford, you were on the stand, as I recall, when we adjourned yesterday on direct examination from Ms. Jones. Please return to the stands as he's doing that. Are there any matters that we need to take up on behalf of the county before we start today?
Not this time.
And any on behalf of Mr. Cranford?
I do have one question.
Yes, ma'am.
I'd like to know. You know, in Superior Court, for example, on any kind of tort-based claim, there's a separate notice for damages. I don't know if that's something that needs to be addressed as part of our case in chief or if it's determined that.
That's not an issue before this board. The issue is if the board finds that there's been a violation of policy, the board can modify the discipline, reinstating, make it a lesser discipline, or affirm the discipline. Those are the choices. There's no ability of the board to, of course, if he is reinstated, he would be entitled to back pay, but that's not an issue. This board rules on in terms of amounts. They just rule how the discipline is changed, if at all. Either it's affirmed or it's reversed in total or in part or modified.
That is our choices.
Okay?
Thank you.
Anything else before we begin this morning? All right. But I'll remind you, you're still under oath.
Yes, sir.
You may continue your examination, Ms. Jones.
Do you recall where we left off yesterday?
I just finished talking about the facts of the form for Chief Chapman. It was the first report after calling Chief Chapman and told me to fill the first report of injury report out and fax it to the other office. So I faxed it to him.
And did you complete any other forms on that day in connection with your injury?
The first report of the injury, and then there's a patient refusal form that goes along with it. You know, state I didn't need any medical attention at the time. You know, no camera turned out that. So I filled that out and faxed that along with it.
Okay, I'm going to show you a copy of what's labeled employee treatment refusal form, mm-hmm. or it's titled that rather. Can you tell me if that's the form that you
have? May I have a copy?
Oh, I'm sorry. Okay. Would like to admit JC1 into evidence?
No objection.
Okay. JC1, which is the employee refusal form,
okay.
Employee treatment refusal form, is admitted without objection.
Initial privilege?
Granted.
Okay. To the best of your knowledge at the time, did you complete all of the forms necessary and properly report your injury?
From what I've been told, yes. I mean, there's never been any kind of training on how to fill out a workman's comp claim. You know, the S drive, which is our internet computer base, has the forms that you're supposed to fill out. Like I said, I've filled out three of these before for minor injuries throughout my career and did them all the same way. I never was told I'd done it right or did it wrong. Nothing was ever said about it. And so I grabbed the workman's comp piece of paper and then the statement sheet and then this refusal form. And to my knowledge, that was all I was supposed to do. You know, forwarded to my superior officer. And like I said, I called him on the phone and he just told me to fax it. So that's what I did. So I thought I'd complete it.
And by naming firefighters Kennelly and Morgan in your statement, did you think that you would comply with requirements regarding witness information?
Yeah, like I said, I never knew that you were supposed to have a witness statement. I was always told that these first report of injuries were for injuries sustained to you, and you told what happened. It wasn't a thing of, you know, you need to have somebody witness it and say, yeah, that's true. I just didn't know that they were supposed to have the business statement. I just didn't know that they were supposed to. So I just put that they were there because they saw it. If there was anything was ever asked, they'd say, yeah, this happened.
And earlier you were testimony for both firefighters Kennerly and Morgan that you had made them aware that you were completing this workers' compensation form. And at least with firefighter Morgan, you asked him to review it before you submitted it. Is that correct?
Yeah, from what they had said, it was first around the table, all three of us, Ked said, and then Sean had said that he walked in on me and Ked, and I told him to review it, which, like I said, I know that we had finished the training, and we had talked about the training, how to get that hired out of the way, and then when we came in to fill out the other trainer report is when I found, you know, my elbow swelling, talked to Chief Chapman, and then, like I said, that long still desk is here, and then the computer desk is there. So I got up from the computer desk, sat here at the steel table to write the first report of injury, and the Ked did the live training. And Sean was just hanging out here. And afterwards, like I said, when I finished it, I was like, hey, y'all care to look over this to see if it's right? That's why y'all are here. Because I know that all paramedic stuff that you write, you know, if you didn't write it, it didn't happen. So I wanted to make sure I didn't leave anything out. So that's it.
Okay, why did you initially refuse treatment on the day?
Like I said, I was more embarrassed about it. More embarrassed about it than anything. You know, I fell off a ladder 2 or 3 foot, you know, by getting tripped in the halyard. I mean, I've been injured. I'm not one that goes to the doctor. I mean, you can see I've had a history of kidney stones since I was 16. I've probably passed 500 kidney stones since I was 16. And I try not to go to the doctor. I'm not a doctor kind of person. So I just thought I was fine. I mean, like I said, it hurt if I extended it all the way out. And like I said, whenever I noticed the swelling, and the next morning it was swollen, I was like, yeah. But I was cool with not messing with it then. I mean, like I said, I could, you know, do okay. So like I said, when Miss Brenda called, I was like, okay, I'll go get an x-ray, sure.
So again, that was at Miss Brenda's suggestion?
Yeah, I mean, like I said, I knew I could take off work. Like I said, I'm 4 kids at home, you know, house payments. I knew I had to be at work, so I would have worked hard. It didn't bother me to do that. But when she said it, I was like, okay, sure, I'll go get an x-ray. Why not, you know?
And do you recall her specifically telling you that she had received a copy of your WC1?
Yeah, that's how she called. She called my cell phone because I was, you know, off shift. And she said, hey, are you okay? And I was like, yeah. And then she said, I got this first report of injury from battalion. And she said, are you sure you're okay? I said, no, I'm fine. I said, it hurts, it's swollen. I said, but I'm good. She goes, well, you need to go get an x-ray.
She specifically said, I just want to clarify, that she did receive the report from battalion.
Yes, ma'am. Okay.
And did she at that time mention anything that might be wrong with your report to you?
No, ma'am.
And did she issue you any kind of instructions about additional steps that would be necessary to complete your claim? At any point on April 3rd, 2011, or any day after that, did anyone approach you and tell you forms were completed incorrectly or that they were incomplete?
No, ma'am.
Exactly, well, what kind of, when did you take on responsibility for completing administrative type forms? So we need to get a lieutenant.
Yes, ma'am. November 26, 2006 is when I was promoted to lieutenant.
Did that include how to fill out these forms, workers' compensation forms? And what instructions were you given at that time?
I said, none. I've never had any workers' comp. I know right now there's a class next door to us that's going on. There's 15 students in there, and there's the first time that form's ever been filled out. And they filled it out, and they all had questions, and the instructor could not answer the questions. And you can go ask all 15 of them, because that's what they said just before. There's never been any kind of training on what to fill out, how to fill it out, who should be notified. You know, reading the thing about the, I was reading Chief Chapman's interview with Lieutenant Lindstrom, and he said normally the safety officers call when the person's injured on the scene, when there's medical treatment required. Well, the second workman's comp injury that I filled out, I was on a fire scene and came out the front door and hyperextended my knee and was seen by me. Chief Chapman witnessed me fall, get hurt. He told me to fill out the workman's comp injury form. I did. He didn't do a witness statement. The medium didn't do anything. There was no safety officer call. You know, it wasn't my responsibility to call that. That would have been his since he was a supervisor, and nothing was said about that.
So, in all of your years working as a firefighter with Forsyth County, have you ever encountered a situation where there has been strict insistence on all kinds of witness statements being gathered in the course of any kind of job-related injury?
Objection to relevance.
Overruled. I'm going to allow it. Go ahead.
No, I mean, it's, like I said, we have one person complete paperwork on the call. You know, you don't have people verifying that what the lieutenant wrote is true. Nobody's ever said you have to have a witness on that.
If there had been a problem with your paperwork, who could you have reasonably expected to review it?
I would assume my battalion chief should review it.
And at the time, that would have been?
Chief Chapman.
And so what was the chain of command with regard to who there was, you as a lieutenant? And that means that you were in charge of your ship, correct? And directly above you was Chief Chapman. And he was over just Station 4?
Yeah, he was over the whole B Shift Battalion, which is Stations 1 through 15.
And it's just B Shift?
B Shift, which, yes, ma'am.
And who was over him?
That's Deputy Chief Dwight Clark.
And does he have a supervisor?
Chief Bowman.
So several people up the chain of command above you.
Yes, ma'am.
Had anyone ever approached you in the past about other administrative or paperwork related to your job?
Objection, relevance.
Sustain.
When precisely were you reassigned from Station 1?
Objection, relevance.
Did this occur after April of 2011?
Yes, it did.
Then I'll allow it. Overruled.
I was notified by telephone on September 18th by Chief Chapman, and he told me that the investigation was completed. I was to return to full-time status. If a Chief Bowman reserves the right to discipline you in the future if needed. And I said, what does that mean? He said, I don't know. He said, I'm reading you the letter that I got. He said, report to Station 1 September 21st. He said, do not go to Station 4. Me and you will go to Station 4 to get your gear together. Do not go to Station 4. I said, okay. So I went to Station 1 on September 21st at 7 a.m., ran some calls in a pair of shorts and a t-shirt because all my uniforms and all my turnout gear were at Station 4. And we finally went to Station 4 to get my stuff at 9:30. But I ran two calls in my shorts that I wore to work and a t-shirt because I didn't have uniform. When I got to Station 4, of course, Engine 4 was gone. Me and I was assigned to Truck 1, which is the tiller truck at Station 1. That's where I was reassigned to. So we took Tiller 1 over to Station 4. And loaded up my bed linens, my uniforms, my turnout gear, my swift water gear, my hazmat gear, my trench gear, everything. We had Tiller 1 packed full, and it was crazy. And on the way back to the Station 1, we ran an alarm call with all that stuff in the back of Tiller 1. ridiculous. But then finally, you know, around 12 o'clock, I started getting all the stuff out of truck one to put at station one. And I was at station one for six shifts from September 21st to October the 6th as a lieutenant on truck one.
As a lieutenant on what?
Truck one.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Was that still a shift?
Yes, sir.
Were you told that was a permanent reassignment?
No, nobody had any answers. Chief Chapman had no clue. He said he was in the dark about the whole situation. He said, I was told you were to come to station one. I said, that's all I know.
Okay, so who was left at station four on B shift at that time?
Objection. Relevance.
That's background, I'll allow it. He knows. Do you know?
Yes, sir. The lieutenant at station one was transferred to station four. Lieutenant Doug Gibson. We just kind of swapped. They swapped us.
Okay, but which crew member was on me?
Sean and Kev remained at station four. Firefighter Kennelly and Firefighter Corrigan, and then Lieutenant Doug Gibson were at station four.
Okay, on the day that you were approached and put on administrative leave by your chief and Ms. Lindstrom, who else was present?
Firefighter Kennelly. And we had a shift worker that day, Donald Wilkinson. I think it's either Williamson or Wilkinson. They were there at the station. And then Sean was there, but he had left to go to workers' comp. You know, his elbow injury that he got injured on the June 29th, he was at physical therapy for that. So the only three people were Ked, Donnie, and myself.
Did you witness his injury?
Yes. Yes, I did.
Did you complete a witness statement?
Is that a no?
Yes, sir. I'm sorry. No witness statement. We didn't fill out a workman's comp form.
It's just when you shake your head, this little recorder doesn't take it down. So when you do that, ask you to respond verbally so it will take it down.
The no workman's comp form, but on NIFRS, our the firehouse report that we have to write for the incident, then I did a witness statement on that, but not for workman's comp.
What is the difference between the two?
Objection. We're going to field here with an entirely separate incident at this point. It has nothing to do with the case at hand.
Response?
I think we're trying to distinguish. You know, the whole issue is that he failed to complete this. Part of the issue is that he failed to complete workers' compensation form correctly. So I think the requisite forms.
I don't think that's the issue at all. I think the issue is whether or not he falsified the workers' comp form. I don't think he's being disciplined for not getting witness statements. I think that's something that was pointed out by the county, that that's what they contend is the usual course, which is why I've allowed you to go in to the fact that this witness says it's not the usual course. But to me, that is a somewhat of a side issue to whether or not he falsified the report in the first place. I think that's the key issue that I've directed your attention to. So I've given you some latitude because, you know, the county pointed out this is the usual procedure. You pointed out to this witness that it's not always the procedure to get witness statements. I'm not going to allow you to go into the other incident beyond what he's already testified to, which is that he didn't fill it out on workers' comp, but he did fill it out on the NIFRS, whatever that is. But that's really not relevant to this board. And I want to so stay. So, with that as an explanation and a ruling, you may proceed.
Thank you. Going back to April 3rd, 2011.
Yes, ma'am.
Oh, I'm sorry. Actually, you said that you were seen by the doctor on April 4th, 2011?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. And were you allowed to continue working for the interim period between your initial visit to the doctor and your follow-up visit?
Yes, ma'am.
And were there any restrictions on your ability to work?
No heavy lifting or something like that. Like I said, I told him, I told Dr. Reagan, I said, I got to work. I said, you know, I'm good to go. I said, most of the things that we do are lifting stretches for the menu, to be honest with you. This is what I'm telling Dr. Reagan. And I said, I've got a crew that I can do. I said, I can work. I do not need to miss work. And so he agreed. He said, okay. And I stayed on status. Like I said, I think, and I don't remember how it's worded in his paperwork, but I think it'd say some restriction, like no heavy lifting or something like that, but I was good to go with that.
Did you request your records from Dr. Reagan at any point in time?
I did after the internal affair, or when I became, after my interview with Ms. Lynch, or Lieutenant Lynchstrom, when I found out what this was all about, I was going to request my medical records from Dr. Reagan.
And whenever you saw him, did you report fully about any prior injuries or any other conditions impacting on your, I guess, overall ability to work?
I'm sorry?
Did you fully disclose all the information to him about any medical conditions yet?
Oh, yes. I mean, like I said, he pretty much knew me or knows me because we get our physicals there every year. So he knows about my history with the kidney stones and, you know, the motorcycle wreck that I had in 2009. Where I'm injured my right shoulder and my left wrist. He knew all that. You know, he asked if there was any other injury from the ladder fall. I was like, no, it's just the elbow. I'm trying to grab this elbow. That was it.
And I'm going to show you where I'm marking as JC2. Please tell me if you can identify these documents. About your visits, correct? To the best of your information and recollection?
I mean, it looks like it is for sure. I mean, nothing has changed in the way.
If you'd like to move these as JC2.
Any objection?
One moment.
Absolutely. This is a multi-page document.
It is.
Seems like this is a multi-date series of documents. It's not just dealing with the fourth, as your counsel was discussing with the witness, but a series of multiple dates and multiple appointments. And I'm not sure that the foundation has been laid properly for the entirety of it. I'm not sure if the board has a concern with that, but it seems like they're dealing with multiple aspects of multiple treatments of some kind, and I'm not sure how much of it, therefore, would be strictly relevant. Based on the lack of foundation.
Under the doctor of completeness, we are hindering the entire series of visits for the board's review. However, we are more than happy to redact after the board.
I'm going to admit JC2 with instruction based on the objection. And here's my instruction to the board. It's admitted the relevant portions of the medical record will relate to elbow injury that was the subject of the workers' comp claim, which is identified perhaps best by FC1. So if there's evidence in there, for instance, related to what Mr. Cranford has testified to, related to his other medical conditions, kidney stones, for example, that's not relevant to your consideration. So there may be extraneous medical information that's contained. I appreciate your proffer from a completeness standpoint, but the relevant portion will be related to the elbow injury and any treatment either before or after the date of the alleged incident related to the elbow injury. So with that instruction,
JC2 is admitted.
Thank you. And it consists of 11 total pages.
Thank you. It's 11 pages, and you may publish if you so desire.
Thank you.
And just to, I guess, clarify, all these are from the other. There's no other. This is follow-up. I'm on the first day. Like I said, he told me to return in 7 or 10 to 14 days for the re-x-ray because of the swelling. So that's the second one. And then the next, because I had visited him 6 times, I went to physical therapy 3 times for the elbow. So that's, these are all from the fall.
Do you know if anything was ever done about the halter? At least, was it done when we were there?
No. I mean, we still have that, you know, that old road. I mean, the difference is kind of the extension ladder.
Okay, so is it uncommon for people to get hurt that way?
Objection. Okay. Relevance.
Response.
Whether or not he falsified an injury, we're now testifying it was a very common injury, actually.
That has no bearing on the question before the board.
I concur. I sustain the objection.
That's all I have at this time, subject to.
Okay.
Thank
Ross?
You. Mr. Cranford.
Yes, sir.
Good morning.
Good morning, sir.
First, I just want to be clear on your job duties when you were a lieutenant. Make sure I understand them before we go into them. As a lieutenant, you were responsible for supervising a shift at one of the county's fire stations, correct?
Yes, sir.
And as part of that supervision, you were responsible for training of subordinates?
Yes, sir.
In the station. You were responsible for assignments of your subordinates in the station?
Yes, sir.
You were responsible for discipline of your subordinates within the station?
Yes, sir.
And you're responsible for maintaining all administrative paperwork at the station.
Yes, sir.
In other words, you had a great deal of responsibility and authority over those people that work below you, correct?
Yes, sir.
Okay. You also were responsible for entering training records into the computer system?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
I'll say yes, sir.
And you were also responsible for maintaining the station logbook when you were on duty?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So to start, let's go back to some of the exhibits we introduced. You recall the photographs that were shown? I don't know if you have it in front of you, but I'm referring to, I believe, FC2, which was the screenshot?
Yes, sir.
Okay. This data that was entered into the system for April 3rd, 2011, that was entered by you, correct?
This, like I said, I'm going to say for sure yes. The normal, like I said, my whole thing is I'm lieutenant, it's my responsibility.
Sure. And then when you pulled it ahead, I believe it's to FC4.
Can we finish our answer?
Did you get water?
No, I'm good. I just...
Then I want you to let him finish
sure thing. Sure. The coughing threw me off. My apologies.
Yeah, sorry. I apologize. I don't know that. Like I said, because I have a normal thing of how I do my training. And, you know, the first thing is doing the white train form, getting the signatures. The white train form is not like this. And I'm sorry that we're not talking about this, but it'll help me not seem like I'm confused. But the white training form is on the S drive. And like I said, that's the computer, internet thing. You go to there, and it's on your computer screen. You type in the information. This is what I do. Type in all the information. As soon as I've typed it, I save it to my iDrive so I can have a copy of it there. I print that out on the computer or on the printer. It comes out. We all sign it. And then I take the signed piece over to the printer and the copier, make a copy for myself, and then I put it in my personal folder that goes into a filing cabinet that's not locked, which I do believe is locked now. But so after I finished that, got that copied, I would come back in and go to the firehouse and then fill out this. The only thing you have to do on this, because this is actually the training division's responsibility, they're responsible for the ISO records and stuff like that. They ask us if as soon as we finished with our white training form, you know, make that copy or give them the original signatures, then they changed it to where they wanted us to start doing this. They asked us if we would fill out this two-hour thing. They said the only thing you have to do is put your date, put the subject that you did, the location, the who did it, you know, the operations, that's that OPS, the station you're at, your shift, and then the engine unit if it's single. If there's more, you can leave that blank. The hours that you wanted, and then put who was there. That's all you had to put. You didn't have to come up here to this rating bureau notes, other or staff survey. So my normal thing is to fill this out, this first sheet, and that's it.
Okay, so just to be clear then, I appreciate the detail of your answer, just to be clear, you're the one who filled out FC2.
Yes, I'm gonna say yes, I filled this out.
Now, looking at FC4, I believe that's the other screenshot, and I may be misquoting here, with the description of the injury you claim happened. And that was also written by you, correct?
I do not remember writing this.
Okay.
And I mean, I'm like I said, I'm not maliciously lying or trying to, but I don't think so. I do not think I wrote this. And the reason, like I said, is because I only did the first sheet. I never did a summary on stuff. I did.
And you wouldn't know then who wrote it?
Yes, sir.
But it's all part of the same system.
Yes.
Now the logbook, and you have a photo of that. I believe it was perhaps FC5.
Six.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
The log entry for April 3rd, 2011, is that all entered by you?
That is all my handwriting, yes, sir.
Okay. And it's your responsibility to keep control and supervision over that logbook when you're on duty, correct?
While I'm there, yes, sir.
Now, prior to April 3rd, 2011, it's true, isn't it, that there was no ladder training at Station 4 under your supervision, correct?
I'm sorry, prior to?
April 3rd, 2011, the date that we're talking about. There was no ladder training under your supervision at Station 4, correct?
False. Yes.
So it is your contention, I want to make sure I'm clear on this, that you had previously conducted ladder training?
Yes.
Under your supervision at Station 4?
Yes.
Okay. Additionally...
Can you tell me the hours?
Pardon me?
Do you want me to tell you how many hours?
No. Additionally, you claimed on your direct testimony that you had previously filled out two prior workers' compensation WC-1 forms, correct?
Yes, sir.
And you signed off on those forms?
Yes, sir.
So those forms would be all in your handwriting?
Yes, sir.
Your signature at the bottom?
Yes, sir.
Show you what I am marking as FC12 and 13. Pardon. Check something. Okay. This is 13. Mr. Cranford, you recognize these documents as WC-1 forms filed in regard to injuries that you sustained previously,
yes,
correct?
Uh-huh.
And they contain your name?
Yes, sir.
Your social security number?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
And they relate to two dates of incidents, 2-26-03 for FC-12 and
9-27-03.
And 9-27-03 for FC-13?
Yes, sir.
And to your knowledge, these are true and accurate copies of those workers' compensation forms?
It looks like everything's filled out correct. This is all my information. Yes, sir.
At this time, I move to admit FC-12 and 13 into evidence.
Objection.
The only question I would have about this is if it's the entire form?
To my knowledge, it's my opinion that this is the form that was on record.
Is it? This is not the same form that I filled out. This is not, we have that new work, this is from 2003. We've revised since then. Like I said, I didn't fill these out.
No objection.
This is from the injuries sustained while training, felt their hole in the training exercise, which was recorded by my lieutenant at the time, as it should have been. And then this one here is I received a burn, which was reported by the chief that was on the scene that time, which it should have been. So they did their job right, as I was a firefighter, I do believe. Yes, I wasn't a lieutenant, I was a firefighter. So they filled out their paperwork correctly.
Okay. I guess we move to admit I'm waiting before I proceed on any questions. So I suspect you just answered them.
I'm going to admit them because Ms. Jones is not objecting to them, but I question the relevance of them. And Mr. Mondelli, that's obviously something for the board to determine a weight to give them, but I'm questioning the relevance of these to the incident that we're here about.
This only goes for the limited purpose of impeachment.
Okay. He said he didn't sign them, they were filled out by somebody else. So let's move on to the next issue.
Just get these to you. We'll not publish. We'll just get the file copy.
Thank you.
Just to be clear then, I just want to make sure you did not actually prepare those two documents.
Yep, sir.
Even though you said previously that you had.
No. I have three copies of the ones I've prepared. I have those. I can show you those. The ones that I repaired or prepared, I have copies of. I did not fill these out. I was a firefighter at the time. I was talking about, sorry that I confused you and the board if I did. I have three workman's comp injury reports that I have filled out different days besides or whatever. Like I said, I stepped on a nail on a scene.
I'm going to stop you, Mr. Cranford. Not relevant.
Okay.
Next question.
Looking at JC2, your medical records.
Yes, sir.
Looking at the first page of them.
Yes, sir.
Okay. This is taking the appointment that was the immediate day after the incident, correct?
Yes. Okay.
And on that day, looking at the diagnosis and notes from the doctor,
mm-hmm.
you would agree with me that it says that there is no edema and no gross deformity.
In
your left arm, your elbow. You'd agree that the diagnosis essentially is for tennis elbow, is that correct?
It does say tennis elbow, yes, sir.
Now, did the doctor explain to you what tennis elbow is?
He did.
I'm going to object to the extent that it calls for the witness to make a diagnosis.
I'm sorry, what was the question? Did the doctor do what I should
explain what tennis elbow is to him?
I think he's asking, in essence, for a hearsay question, which is admissible in front of this board, so. He can, if Mr. Cranford knows, if the doctor said anything related to it, then and you recall it, you can answer that question. I'm going to overrule the objection and allow you to answer it if you remember or if he said, but obviously I don't want you to speculate.
I'm sorry,
you remember.
I was actually a little late with the objection. My objection was to the question before that, asking him whether or not he would agree that he had basically been diagnosed with tennis elbow.
These are documents that she introduced and had admitted.
Well, I'm going to sustain the objection to what his understanding of the diagnosis. The document speaks for itself. Now, you can ask him what the doctor told him and what his understanding is, but you can't ask him, what's the diagnosis? What's the prognosis? I mean, that's a medical issue that only the doctor can testify to, or if the doctor's not going to be here, I've admitted this report, so to the extent that this report contains diagnosis or prognosis, either of you can argue to the board in your closing about that. But I'm not going to allow this witness to give medical testimony, even though I think he has some medical training, obviously based on his paramedic status, but he's not going to be allowed to testify about that. Next question.
So just to be clear, with regard to what the doctor told him.
You can ask him that, absolutely.
Mr. Cranford, I'll repeat my question.
Yes, sir.
Did the doctor explain to you what tennis elbow is?
He did.
And what did he explain to you?
Well, he did the x-ray first, came back and told me that there was too much edema to be seen on the x-ray, I need to come back. He said, it looks like tennis elbow. And I said, tennis elbow? I said, I thought tennis elbow was degenerative from, you know, playing tennis. He said, well, most of the time it is. He said, but you can get tennis elbow when you fall and the leg hit the radial ulnar nerve and you chip that, you know, in your elbow. And I said, okay. And that was basically all I said.
To make sure I understand what you just said, the doctor told you tennis elbow was typically gotten from repetitive motion.
No, I told him, I said, I thought tennis elbow.
And he agreed with
you. He said, normally it is. Okay. He said, but you can also get tennis elbow when you have blunt, direct trauma to the elbow.
In other words, there are two ways you can get tennis elbow. The common way is repetitive motion, as you described.
Again, objection to the extent it calls for him to make a medical diagnosis.
I'm allowed to answer this because I think Mr. Mondelli is basically repeating what he understands the witness has just said and asking him to either agree or disagree. To the extent of what the doctor told you.
Yeah, I mean,
that's all you can testify to.
So, going back to my question, there are essentially, based on your understanding, your conversation with the doctor, there are essentially two ways you can get tennis elbow.
Yes, sir.
One, and the way that you asked the doctor about, was through repetitive motion.
Yes, sir.
And the other is from the impact that can sometimes happen on the elbow itself.
Yes. And that's how he told me I got the tennis elbow, was from the direct fall.
Isn't it true you have a second business or second job?
I have a landscape business, and I just started a inflatable bounce house business.
Okay. How long have you had the landscape business?
Objection is to relevance. I think this
subject
is outside
the connection.
I'm going to give him some life to you. He's got him on cross. You've had a landscape business for how long?
It's been a long time since, I want to say 98, but like I said, I would have to go back to see when I first got my business.
And in that landscaping business, you do a lot of the work yourself?
Yes, sir.
You're not just sitting in an office managing
other people. My landscape business, what I do is I cut grass. I don't do any kind of installation. I don't install sod, tar sod. I don't do designs. I just take a lawnmower, cut grass, and then weed.
So you push a lawnmower back and forth?
No, I ride a lawnmower.
Okay, ride
it's
lawnmower.
A commercial lawnmower.
And you have a weed whacker?
Weed eater.
Weed eater. Send that back and forth?
Yes, sir.
Okay. And you do that pretty often?
Yes, sir.
Okay. And you've been doing that weed eater business since
98? I'm going to say 98. Like I said, I would have to, you know, like I said, I'll say 98.
Okay. One moment. You mentioned the that you had filled out this training report.
Yes, sir.
And this was introduced for demonstrative purposes.
I have filled out a training report. I didn't fill out for this incident that you're talking about.
So you did not complete a training report for April 3rd?
That's the one that Ken filled out.
That Ken filled out. So it's your testimony today.
And the reason that I can say that is because, as I just told you earlier, my normal thing is I do type out on a computer and then I save it to my iDrive. That day there is not on my iDrive, as told by Lieutenant Lindstrom yesterday, as she confirmed it. And I remember telling Kid, I want to fill out this Roman's comp form. You start that training form there, because as I said, he was going through instructor training school and wanted to do the filling out of forms.
Are we talking about Firefighter Kennerly?
Kennerly, yes, sir. I'm sorry. Firefighter Kennerly.
And that's your testimony today?
Yes, sir.
What happened to the form after you say Kennerly filled it out?
We all signed it. Like I said, then Ked went outside to make the copy, brought it back in, and put it in the yellow folder that sits beside the computer, A, B, and C shift, that's supposed to go up to training. It was put in there. And then the copy was placed in my personal file in the filing cabinet in the office.
And is your testimony today that you can't account for what happened to that document after the suspension began?
I don't know where it's at. I have no idea. Like I said, whenever she came and told me I had to leave, I went back to Station 4 that day on September 21st to get my stuff. I didn't know it was missing.
And isn't it true that's the only document that has the signature of any other individual corroborating
this
accident?
Yes.
In fact, JC1 has a space for a supervisor signature on it. And that space is also blank for this instance, correct?
Yes. As I was told to fax that form to attach.
Now, referring back to, I believe, FC-10, which is the memorandum you received about being taken off paid leave.
Yes, sir.
Okay. You received a copy of that, did you not?
Yes, sir. Okay.
And you were clear by looking at Section 2 that this disciplinary question issue was still open with regard to a decision from the chief.
I was confused. Like I said, I received a telephone call from Chief Chapman on Sunday the 18th, and he read this to me. And then when he said number two, la-di-da-da, what reads here, I said, well, what's that mean? He said, I don't know. He said, I'm just reading what I've got. So on the 19th, the Monday, I called Miss Pat Carson because Lieutenant Lindstrom said that was the only person I had any contact with. I called her, and I asked her. And she said, no, she goes, you're off administrative leave, your case is closed, you're to return to full-time status, but Chief Bowman does want to sit down and talk with you. And I said, okay, sounds good to me. And that was it.
So at that time you understood that Chief Bowman was going to be doing something further with this case?
Yeah, like she said he wanted to sit down and talk with me.
And you just didn't know exactly what that was?
No, I didn't know. I thought he was going to say, I didn't know. I mean, I was, you know, positive because I was like, this is great. Of course, confused on why this was all up, but I was like, yeah, finally, you know, I'm going back on the engine. So I was looking forward to talking with him. I didn't know it was for him to fire me.
I have nothing further subject to redirect.
Can I have just one moment, please?
Sure.
Objection, and I'll probably re-raise it in a minute.
Why don't you just tell us what that document
is?
Don't read it to us. Tell me what the title of it is.
Oh, this is Fundamentals of Firefighter Skills, Chapter 12, Ladders. He just asked me if I never have, he told me I never have.
So, just stop right there. I'll let people ask you a question. I just want to know what we're talking about.
This is
the title of the document.
So it's a trainer report for ladder training.
Okay.
What date is on this report?
This is July the 4th, 2018.
Okay, and is this what you filled out?
Yes.
The report you filled out?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, and who does it report training for?
Myself and Firefighter Kennerly.
Okay, we'd like to admit JC3, training report dated 7/4/2010.
I'll renew my objection. Go from there.
Okay, can I see the document? to overrule the objection and admit JC3 over objection. I believe that the county opened the door by asking a question about prior training and related ladders, and so for that limited purpose, I'm going to allow.
Thank you. Permission published.
Permission granted. Again, the details of all that and what happened on that day are not relevant. The fact that it happened is relevant and is admissible.
JC4 and JC5 has had to mark these two documents. May I ask you if you can identify them and tell us what they are, please?
These are the other, this is the,
do JC4 first, if you don't mind.
Yes, sir. JC4 is the first workers' comp injury report that I filled out. JC5 is the second one. Of course, the third one is what we're talking about today. These are the workman's comp forms that I filled out before. It's probably just like this one we're talking about today.
I'd like to admit JC4, which is, what are the two dates on these stuff? I'm sorry, what is the date on JC4?
JC4 is January the 2nd, 2010.
Okay.
And then JC5 is February the 27th, 2011.
And these are both reports of injury or first compensation forms?
Yes, ma'am.
I'd like to admit JC4, which is the workers' compensation injury form dated January 2nd, 2010, and JC5, workers' board, or workers' compensation board injury form dated February 27th, 2011.
No objection.
You're admitted without objection.
Questions?
Granted. Okay, recross, limited to the scope of redirect.
Regarding JC3,
yes,
the training form that was just presented, is it your contention that this is the only training at Station 4 of the Navajo Ladders?
No, sir.
Okay.
That's why it surprised me that both Ken and our firefighter Kennerly and firefighter Corrigan both said they'd never had ladder training at Station 4. I have their signatures on a lot of these.
All right, nothing further.
All right, questions from the board. Mr. Blanchard?
I just have one equipment here.
Yes, sir.
On this training report on JC3, why is there none showing for the day that you got hurt on training?
That's, I don't know, somebody's taking it, it's been misplaced. I don't know where that training report is. Yeah, I know there was one filled out, I know we all three signed it. Where it went from there, I have no idea.
Okay, nothing further, thank you.
Mr. Smith?
I have a few questions. On FC-11, and is your employee warning report today that you were terminated?
Yes, sir.
I think the date is 9/16/11 on this.
Yes, sir.
Well, that's when it originated, but you signed it on 10/6/2011. You disagreed with the county statement. You checked that out?
Yes, sir.
That you did put for the following reasons?
Yes, sir, I did.
You did?
I was told by Chief Baldwin, of course, of my right to appeal. And I said, well, how am I supposed to appeal when you've taken all of my, you know, community devices to get in touch with the appeal process to him? And he said, here's a piece of paper, write it out. So they gave me a piece of paper and I handwritten a appeal to him, which is over there. That was taken by Chief Clark and signed for 10-22 hours. And then they made copies of it.
Signed for what now? 10 what?
10-22 hours, because my dismissal conference was October the 6th at 10 a.m. At 10:22, Chief Clark, I say that because he was sitting beside me, he took my handwritten informal appeal and he signed it that he received it. So then he was going to give it to Chief Bowman.
Okay.
But there is a copy of that. And like I said, I have it over there.
Okay. Well, that answers my question, because as you see, this is blind.
Yes, sir.
And I didn't understand it. While we're talking about the dismissal here, I'm not sure that I understood yesterday when you briefly touched upon it. If it started at 10 o'clock, to the best of your recollection, would you please tell me what transpired actually between 10 o'clock and 10:22, since that's when that was timed? 22 minutes, could you tell me what was said, who said it, the whole layout, the whole dismissal conference?
Really, the only person that talked during that was Chief Bowman. As Cheryl Robinson said yesterday, she told you who all was there. They were all present. And Chief Bowman did. He said, Lieutenant Cranford, it's been brought to my attention that, you've lied on some training for me. You've lied on a report of injury. Is that true? Did you lie? I said, no, sir, it's not. He said, well, I have the sworn testimony of two firefighters that stayed out of it. I said, I don't know why they're saying that it didn't happen. And he said, I don't know why they're saying the same thing. He said, but I've got the two sworn testimony from your firefighters. And then he kept on talking like that. And he said, Chief Chapman, come up here and read this. He said, this is not a democracy, but I'm just going to let you see what I'm about to do. So Chief Chapman walks behind me, signs it. He says, Chief Chapman, you're concerned. And Chief Chapman said, I am not privy to the information, so I stand behind your decision and whatever you say. He said, okay. I said, Lieutenant Cranford, the sworn statements and sworn testimony of your two firefighters trumps your Georgia report of first injury. You're terminated. And I said, excuse me? And I laughed. And the reason I did is because Chief Bowman has a tendency to fire you, demote you, 24-hour suspend you. What I mean is, he'll hand you a piece of paper saying you're fired. Then he'll say, well, okay, I'm going to demote you. You get 20. I don't know if it's an authority thing or what. That's what he does. So I laughed because that's what I thought he was doing. And when I realized that he wasn't playing, I said, are you kidding me? I said, you're firing me over hearsay that occurred 5 months ago? I said, these two guys come and say that I didn't do this. And I said, you're taking their word over mine. I said, I've never been in trouble before. I've been here 11 years. I said, I'm a Valor Award recipient from the governor of Georgia, and you're going to take their word for that? And he said, yes. He said, I said, well, what about the white training form? I said, they signed that. He said, they said you forced them to sign it. You intimidated them to sign that. And I said, no, I didn't. I said, well, what about the workman's comp doctor? What did he say? And he said, the workman's comp doctor said he could not tell when you were injured. He said, you may appeal your firing first through me. And then that's when I said, you told me I don't have any contact with you. You're taking everything. How much? Here's a piece of paper. Captain Shivers gave him a piece of paper laying right in. And he stormed off. At 10:22, Chief Clark signed my thing, handed it. At 10:33, Chief Bowman sent out an email promoting the next guy. I went to, whenever Chief Bowman, like this is all recorded, I have a recording of this.
All this was taking place while you were in the dismissal.
Yes, this is all from 10 o'clock to 10:22. When the 1022, and at 1033, the email went out promoting another lieutenant. Whenever he told me that Firefighter Kennerly and Firefighter Corrigan said that I threatened them, that I made them sign the lot training form, that's when I said, we got to find the lot training form. I didn't know it was missing that time. Whenever he told me that the workman's comp doctor said that he couldn't tell when I was injured, I then went to the workman's comp doctor and said, hey, has the county came to you asking about this? No, nobody's came here asking for your medical records.
You're absolutely certain that Chief Bowman said that both Kennerly and Corrigan said that they had signed the training form,
yes,
but that you had forced them to?
Yes, I have that tape recording.
That's on tape?
Yes, sir.
Who got promoted to lieutenant?
Firefighter Kennerly's best friend, Keith Perchie.
Who?
Keith Perchie.
Okay. Was he? He wasn't a lieutenant until that day.
Exactly. They had taken the lieutenant's test, and that lieutenant's test is good for a year. So you know, you finish first, second, third. So if anybody gets fired, promoted, or God forbid, killed in the line of duty, then they pick from that list. Keith Perchie is the next one.
You heard the testimony from Firefighter Kennerly and Firefighter Corbin. They both denied. They said that they had not signed the training form. Is that not the testimony that they gave here?
That's what they said, yes, sir.
Yes. But during the dismissal hearing, Chief Bowman said that they had admitted that they had signed it.
Yes, sir.
You're certain of that?
Yes, sir.
Okay. The central figure in all of this is Chief Chapman. I understood Ms. Lindstrom's testimony, and if I misunderstood it, then please tell me how you understood it. She said that in her interview with Chief Chapman, that he couldn't remember talking to you.
That's what she said, yes.
Was that her testimony?
Yes.
Have you at any time since your termination, before your termination, have you ever questioned Chief Chapman and asked him, do you remember me calling you?
Yes.
And what did he say?
He said, he knew that he called. It's even in his interview, that the 5-minute interview that she did with him, he states he knows that he called me, or that I called him.
Reporting your injury?
Yes. Because he even said, do you need medical attention? And I said, and Lieutenant Cranford said no. I told him it's in the Chief Chapman's interview, this one that she has written out. It doesn't say that he said he doesn't remember talking to me.
It doesn't say that.
No, it says he knows he talked to me. That's like yesterday when Lieutenant Lindstrom said that when I interviewed with her, she said she couldn't remember if I called Chief Chapman, that I just faxed him. No, in my interview, it states that I said I called Chief Chapman.
And Chief Chapman has never denied that you called him?
No, sir.
Do you have any idea why Chief Chapman didn't sign your WC-1?
I don't know. He said, when she asked him in his interview, did you sign the workman's comp form? He says, quote unquote, apparently I did not.
And also on that, was it JC-3? There was a form there that didn't have a signature either on it.
No, this is a trainer that has a signature.
Which one was it? One, FC-1?
Yes, sir.
Does it have a signature on it?
It's got mine. Like I said, I filled out three things, which is the first page of the workman's comp form, which should be a front and back, but since it's on that S drive, and we have to print it out, it comes out as one page, and then this thing. So the workman's comp thing talked about the injury, and then my statement of what happened, and then this employer refusal as well.
And you said that you faxed that to the tag?
Faxed that to the
tag. And it wasn't signed off?
But I don't know why he didn't sign it before he signed it up.
Why do you think, your personal opinion, why do you think that Firefighter Corbin and Firefighter Kennerly did not tell the whole truth to this boat?
You know, I've thought about that a lot. I mean, I don't understand why. I mean, I know me and Kent's had some little squabbles, but really not wanting to, you know, I think their motive is, as they state in their sworn statement to Lieutenant Lindstrom, we both request a new lieutenant, is what they state. I think because, like I said, Kent, and it's, I'm not, he's medicated, and it's on file with the county. Firefighter Kennelly is medicated.
What kind of medication does he take?
Depression. He says he's a bipolar. Depression. He's got high blood pressure. Just different kinds of stuff. I mean, cholesterol. You know, he's had congestive heart failure. He's on some heart medicines. Stuff like that. But I don't know the names of them for sure. I mean, there's a lot. But so he's moody a lot. You know, and so he got into a habit, which I was fine with, because my whole thing is Monday we have truck day, Tuesday's ladder days, Wednesday's house day. You know, we have days like that. So I said, look, as long as we come here, we check our truck off, we get our stuff done that we have to, you can do what you need to do. If it's play on the computer, if it's sleep, if it's talk to your wife, I don't care. I mean, of course you can't miss a call. If public comes in, you need to be at attention. But Ken had gotten into the habit of coming in, checking the truck off at 7, going to sleep until 12. And so whenever Sean came back from his injury, me and him were talking, and I said, look, I said, we're going to have to stop this stuff. I said, we had till the end of June to finish the EMS research, the paramedic, the EMT stuff. I said, we're done that. I said, we've got to start our Red Book stuff. And I said, we're not going to come in and go to sleep till 12. We're not going to come in and play on the computer. The TV's not going to come on till 5. I think he probably went to Ked and told Ked that, or Firefighter Kennelly, and then shortly after Sean was out. So I'm assuming, I would speculate, that they didn't want to, you know, start not watching TV or not get on the computer or not sleep until 12. It's the only thing I can think is a good reason why they would want to know.
Everything you said about Firefighter Kennelly, do you think Firefighter Corrigan, because he was younger, newer on the force, that he went along with?
I think that's why. That's what it looked like to me. I mean, he wouldn't look me in the eye yesterday. I think he was, you know, knows that it's not true, and he was just going along with the kid. And I don't know. I mean, I know that we trained. I know that I failed. It was no big deal. I would have been good with not going to the doctor. Like, see, Ms. Brenda Green called me, and I was like, sure, I'll go get an X-ray. And then I went back because the doctor kept saying, come back. I didn't say, let me come back, or give me this medicine. No, I can't work. Give me a letter. I didn't do any of that.
You heard Firefighter Kennelly testify when your attorney mentioned other requests for transfer. Don't think I missed it, but did you hear Firefighter Kennerly say that he had only made one request?
I don't remember him saying.
And he went into detail. It was about the earphone thing.
Yeah, you, I guess I do remember that. Yeah.
You testified that he had made two other requests, a total of three.
Yes.
I didn't hear him mention those others, but
I know that that's why he gave the initial reason of going to Lieutenant Lindstrom instead of his battalion, because he said that he would think, with all the other times that he went to the battalion on those requests, that battalion would have told him just to deal with it. That's what it says in his sworn statement.
Okay. My last question is this. I find it very odd, human nature-wise, that nobody, none of the three of y'all, nobody got mad at anybody else. Did you testify yesterday that you and Firefighter Kennerly had played golf, continued to play after this?
Yes.
And both of the firefighters testified that they still respected you and liked you?
Yes.
I don't understand that in human nature. I don't understand you.
Me? Oh, I'm mad. I'm really mad. I've been so mad. I've cried. I've hit stuff. Just because. You always hear people say, oh, I wouldn't go into a burning building with that guy because they don't know what they're doing. You don't want somebody to leave. And I've never had that mentality because I'm an instructor. I know what to do by myself kind of stuff. But you always wonder if you're laying trapped under something, if you're out of air, you want to know that your firefighters will pull you out. That's all you really care about. You know? And that's what hurts me more about anything. I'm like, if they're going to lie about this because they want another lieutenant, what if I'd have made them mad that morning and we had a structure fire and they were just going to leave in a house fire? So that's pissed me off bad. Excuse my French, which actually I'm pretty good. I usually cuss it out. But that, I've calmed down a lot. I mean, it's been 3 months.
Do you still want to maintain a relationship with those two good gentlemen?
I don't think I can. I mean,
you realize that they cost you your job.
I do know that. Yes.
They've also, what they've been accused of doing, you understand that's a criminal offense.
Yes, sir. Yes, and that's why I you know, yesterday when Ken walked in, he waved at me. I'm like, don't wave at me. You know, I'm mad. But I'm professional too. I want my job back. I don't want to go beat his ass. I don't want to go beat his tail or beat Sean up, because in my younger years, that's what I'd have done. They would have told an ass whooping, for sure. I played college baseball. I played every sport that you can think of, and I'm competitive. Whenever I lost my job over this, I thought, there is no way. And then I read that I lost my job on not an investigation, and that's what made it. It was an interview. I had Sean's interview was 5 minutes. Ken's was 21 minutes. I was interviewed for 41 minutes, and Chief Chaplin was interviewed for 5 minutes. And I'm like, I'm being fired on hearsay. Never been in trouble before. Up until just before that, which was under appeal, but whenever Lieutenant Lindstrom told me that I couldn't have any contact, then I had to stop my formal appeal. That's under the bridge. But a good, great, wonderful employee for the county, I'd always thought. Received letters from Chief Bowman talking about how great, what an idea. And then for him to talk to me like he did that day, made me mad, upset me.
Last question. Your attorney has introduced evidence that you did do ladder training.
Yes, sir.
You heard Corrigan and Kennerly say that they'd never had ladder training. Is your testimony here that you could produce other documents showing that you'd had ladder training?
From 2009 until 2011, Ked has signed right there 84 hours of ladder training. Sean has 26 hours of ladder training at Station 4. That's not counting the headquarters, that's at Station 4. That when they said in their sworn statement, never had ladder training, I went through and pulled up, and they have had ladder training at Station 4.
I have one more question.
Dr. Powell, any questions? Cranford, I'd like you to take a look at FC1. Should be the first report of injury. Tell me when you got it from.
The front end, all of it, or just that?
Just
yes, sir.
Appears to me from the top of it that this was faxed at 8:13 from Station 4 to a number that's not fully showing up on this copy. It looks like probably because somebody put hole punches at the top of it, and so the top of the receipt number is not fully there. Okay. Not worried about that. Here's my concern. 18:13 would be 6:13 p.m. Correct? And this document says that it's page one of 4 pages. Do you know what the fourth page was? There's only 3 pages here.
To Chief Chaplin.
Cover sheet.
Okay, so the cover sheet was the last page?
I would guess so.
Okay, that doesn't make any sense to me.
The fourth page would have been the refusal of treatment.
That's what I would have assumed. The document that's been entered into evidence has no fact stamp across it. So that's why I wanted to ask that question. It may just be that that's because the refusal form that's been entered into evidence is the original that was gotten to the file, and this copy is a fax copy. I'm just trying to figure out what page 4 was.
Yes, sir. It should have been there, because like I said, I've faxed these things, and then the
refusal is what you think is page 4.
I believe so, yes, sir.
I assumed as much, but I've learned long ago to quit relying on assumptions and find out for sure what your testimony was.
I agree.
You answered this question in part with Mr. Smith, but I just want to follow up. This whole case revolves around an incident that allegedly happened on April 3rd, 2011. Do you know of any reason why Firefighter Corrigan and Kennerly would say it never happened?
Like I said, the only thing I can think of is, as they state, they want a new lieutenant.
Can you think of any reason why they would say that this incident never happened and that they covered it up for a period of 5 months, thereby subjecting themselves to potential discipline? That doesn't make any sense to me either. You don't know.
I don't think they know that they could get in trouble.
You don't think so?
I don't think so. I mean, I'm almost 100% sure Sean has no idea. Because like I said, Sean's not from Firefighter. He's brand new.
He met a retail, I think.
Yes, he was
testified.
Restaurant manager. So he's always been there. So I think he has no idea that he could be in trouble. I'm sure Kev doesn't, or Firefighter Kennerly doesn't either. Because I think if they did, they wouldn't have said it.
On the 3rd, how far from a distance perspective did you fall?
Like I said, I was on the, to the best of my knowledge, like the second, third, or fourth rung, which would have probably been up to here. I was on a 24-foot extension ladder, so 2 to 3 foot. And then I just, whenever my foot got tangled, because I went to, I think it was my right foot, as I was coming down to go to the next one, got tangled, and I just fell over, hit the ground there.
Okay, so when you fell over and hit the ground, I believe you testified earlier, or someone did, that Kennerly was at the bottom of the ladder, supposedly holding it in place. That was his job. There's a name y'all give to that person.
He's the heel person.
The heel person. Okay, I'll use your terminology. So you would have fallen right next to Kennerly?
No. You'll imagine the building behind me, the ladder coming this way, right. And then Firefighter Kennerly here. So I'm coming down the ladder this way. So when I fell, I went here.
You fell right in front of me?
Yes.
I mean, you had to be within, inches or a foot or two.
Like I said,
he was looking at you.
Yeah, he was, like I said.
That's right.
Yeah, he's looking at me. I'm coming down this, he's here. If I get up.
Yes,
so
sir.
He's doing this, because the building's behind, the ladder's on me. So he's doing this, and then I'm coming down, and then I fall this way. So when I hit here, he's over here.
A couple of feet away.
Yes.
Which is kind of what led to my next question. Is there any way you could have fallen on the 3rd, and Kennerly and Corrigan not see it?
No, they saw it, because as I jumped up, they both came over there. Man, you okay? You okay? I was like, yeah, I'm fine. I said, we're good. I said, man, we got to get this halyard fixed. And then we started talking about that.
Okay, so where was Corrigan at the time? I understand where Kennerly was. He was up on the roof.
He came down the ladder. He already came down the ladder and was, walking, or just here, on this side here, standing there, waiting for me to come down.
So he was on the same side that you fell?
No, he was on the right side.
So he was on the other side of where you fell?
Because when he came off the ladder, he went to the right side. And I just come down and I went to the left.
Okay. So, no way that Corrigan couldn't have noticed you falling.
No. Like I said, they both came, oh, man, you're okay. And I was like, yeah, I'm good. Because we were all right there.
You testified that afterwards, y'all come in the kitchen, and you're filling out at some point in time after this, you're filling out the WC1, which is SC1.
Yes, sir.
Exhibit here. And that Firefighter Kennerly is filling out the training report that we don't have for whatever reason. But you saw him filling this out, and you testified that y'all all signed it.
Yes, sir.
What you haven't said, and I hadn't heard from anybody yet, is what did the training report say? You remember? What did it say?
Because Ked asked me what was supposed to say. Don't forget about this morning. Because on our truck check offs, we checked our truck off, and then we grabbed the ladder out, practiced carrying the ladder. Laid it against the station, of how to secure it, stuff like that. I said, You know, so that's, we'll say an hour there, and then an hour on this part here, so 2 hours, put 2 hours. And I said,
of ladder training.
Ladder training. I said, you know, you can say that we deployed those, and then talk about, you know, simulation of ventilation practices by, with new recruit. Because like I said, we, Sean was new, so a lot of the stuff we did training for just Sean, you know, to help him out, or all of them, really, you know, we have
to. So you told me what you told him it should say. Do you remember what he wrote?
Yeah, it was to that, it was, you know, ladder training complete, ventilation practice scenarios forgiven with new recruit or something like that.
And was the sole entry that he made related to ladder training?
Yes.
Did you do any other training that day?
So we did 8 hours of EMS training.
And was there any note about the EMS training?
On the logbook there is.
Thank you, Mr. Smith. My question is, on the training report that Firefighter Kennerly was filling out, did he just write about ladder
just
training?
Ladder. Yes, sir.
Why wouldn't he write about the medical training on the training log?
That's a different report. Another report shouldn't have been filled out for that. When you do, say, ladder training, you do ladder training. And then, like I said, for ISO, for Georgia State Recertification, you can't do fire, or you can't get credit for EMS training. So that has to be a different training report.
But do you fill out a training report that looks like this JC3 for the EMS training?
Yes.
And a separate one. So what you're telling me is there should be two training logs from April the 3rd that Kennerly filled out.
No.
And
the reason I say no is because we received an email from Captain Rick Hamilton in January stating that we had to complete a work for our EMS research. And so I told the guys we have till June to finish this book because it was a workbook. It wasn't something that you could get done quick. So I said, we'll do June. That was for 50, I think it's, I don't want to lie, but I think it's 54 hours of research hours is what they have deemed that is. And so I was keeping up with the EMS training here, 8 hours, and then June, at the end of June, come in there to finish it all so we could turn in that book right there. That's the paramedic workbook, the EMS workbook. And so I would have it all together instead of having a 2 hour day here, you know, having a bunch of them, it would all just be one that's 54 hours and then turn that in.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
It does, but I want to ask my question a different way.
Okay.
Are you supposed to fill out a training report on every bit of training that you do?
You're supposed to.
And when you do that, let me just ask, follow up on that. Are you supposed to have a different piece of paper for different types of training?
Yes.
So, like, let's say that you did ladder training in the morning, and in the afternoon you did some sort of training related to operation of the fire truck. I'm just making that up.
Yes,
would you have two pieces of paper?
Two different training programs.
Okay. So back to my question from before. I understand about your workbook and filling that out, but you tell me the policy was that you should have had two pieces of paper for April 3rd that looked like JC3, or no?
No, you, like I said, because the training on that book has not completed yet. Is that right? Because say like if we had have started that ladder training that morning, and then we didn't do the afternoon, then the next day we came in and did the afternoon, then I could sit there and say, you know, on Sunday, April the 3rd, started off carrying ladders. On Wednesday, April the 6th, we finished up by doing ventilation. We could combine that together.
In one training report?
Yes.
Okay, and that's my question. Is there a separate training report for the medical training, the 8 hours of medical training that you did, or is it all in the workbook that you just described?
It's all in that workbook.
Okay, so there's not a separate piece of paper for the training report related to the medical 8 hours that you did on April the 3rd.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, back to the training report that Kennerly, you saw fill out a report related to the ladder training.
Yes, sir.
Did it say anything that you, okay, not what you told him to write, but what, did you read it before you signed it?
Yes.
Did Kennerly sign it?
Yes.
Did Corrigan sign it?
Yes.
Did you see them sign?
Yes, on the rest of the table, yes.
And when you read it, did it say anything about you falling?
No.
Nothing on there about you falling. Is that usual or unusual in your opinion? If someone is injured during training, you not only note that in the training report, or would you not put that in?
I don't think so, because that's the training form. You know, the other disformance comp thing would put, you know, see training form for that if you want to, for whatever. But yeah, it's not my practice to, you know, if we got hurt in training to say someone was hurt, see disformance comp form. I've never done that way. I mean, I've never been told that yet.
I understand that. I'm just trying to find out the facts. All right. This is my practice. A lot of my questions, if the board has any questions, I will allow them to follow up based upon those questions. Mr. Blanchard, do you have any follow-up questions based upon those questions?
Do you have a feeling of why they might want another, what they would gain by getting another lieutenant? I mean, were things that bad with you there that they have to seek another lieutenant?
Like I said, the only thing, and I'm speculating because I don't have a clue, but Kev and Keith Percher are real good best friends, computer buddies kind of thing. And I figured, you know, that if Sean went to him and said, hey, we can't do computers till after 7, we can't watch TV till after 5, you know, we can't sleep till 12, then Kev probably went and thought, hey, Keith, you know, he's next on the list, he'll be the next lieutenant, let's get rid of him. But the funny thing about that is, Kev's already requested a transfer to become up to station fellow, so he don't want to work for Keith now. So he's already got another lieutenant since that time. But I would speculate it was because of the, you know, like I said, no sleep until noon, no TV. That's all I could think of. I mean, we didn't, like I said, we played golf together. We did stuff.
None of this was discussed over golf or anything like that?
No. I mean, and that's, doesn't make sense. You know, like I said, if we're playing golf together, why would he say, man, I really hate that you lied about that, man. Why would you do that? Why wouldn't he have done that? He never talked to me. I was blindsided. I mean, as she told you, didn't have a clue what to do. I kept asking her. She finally got very strong and said, I can't say nothing. Stop asking me.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. Smith, any follow-up questions?
One more. If you remember, Firefighter Kennerly was very graphic in stating the exact place you were standing around the metal counter or island. That was the example.
Yes, sir.
And Firefighter Kennerly said all three of y'all were standing around and you told them to read it and did you have a problem with it? It wasn't until Firefighter Corrigan testified, he wasn't there most of that time. But did you find that odd?
I did. You know, like I said, their stories didn't match. I mean, it was, like I said, Ken said we were at the island and then Sean comes in and says he was outside and walked in on us having a conversation.
Spent 2 minutes there was what he said. I don't have anything.
Dr. Cobb?
No, I haven't.
All right. We will take our morning break. We'll be in recess for approximately 5 to 8 minutes and then we'll resume. Who will your next witness be, Ms. Jones?
Paul Tripp.
Paul, who wants to?
Tripp.
Okay. And so to make sure that he's here and available. That'd be great. Thank you. We'll be in recess.
What was the name of the next witness?
T-R-I-P-P, I assume. Paul Tripp.
Just, it happened to me.
That's T-R-I-P-P.